Cody in I Live Here.
Michael Cody has lived most of his life in his hometown of Carrick-on-Shore since his birth in 1939. Father of two daughters, schoolteacher, poet-writer, trombone player, bandmaster, and journalist, he's immersed in what goes on here. The Codys are long established in Carrick and can be traced to the days the town thrived with a population of 11,000, twice what unemployment and emigration has done to it today. His pen has earned him prizes at Listowel Writers Week and RTE. He holds the Patrick Kavanagh Award for the sometimes amusing, occasionally sardonic, and frequently passionate voice he raises in poetry, capturing the moods and rhythms of life in the town, recalling its glories and defeats. When Oven Lane, his second collection of poems, was published by Gallery Press in 1987, Carrick's Brewery Lane Theatre was packed. The book was launched by his lifelong friend, another Carrick man, the entertainer, Liam Clancy.
Stand at the turn and see quite clearly Kennedy's Hotel, no longer there. Hold in the eye this void where everything ordinary happened in its time, and slow dissolving into a clarified intrigue of space.
There's a Kenny's Stone around here somewhere. Kenny's Stone.
Just here, did you see that corner?
Yeah.
Right space out there it is.
Did you ever see it bare?
Huh?
Did you ever see
I
it bare?
Yeah, yeah.
The river is central to Carrick. It's a great universal symbol anyway, a river. And to me, a river and a town is a sort of a liberation of spirit. I can't imagine living in a town without a river or without moving water. All our traditions are echoed and realized around the river because it brought Carrick into being. And flowing water to me refreshes the mind and the spirit, and it's a symbol, a changing but never changing symbol always.
Yes. There was a rock in the middle of the river there, now in the centre one time, and the boat club took it away out of it.
Yes.
And then next, I heard always that that's where Carrick got its name from.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Huh?
I've heard that.
There's something that fascinates me about the river too, that it is both docile and untamed at once, at the same time, like a cat that lies in the laps of our lap of our lives and our history. I think of it that way very often.
Forts actually docked in the castle long ago, I understand.
As a writer, in a small community, your particular challenge is to focus closely on the grain in the wood, so to speak. And the closer you focus, the more the thing opens out, so that the concept of small or large becomes almost meaningless if you do focus closely enough.
Imagine the moment an acorn settled in the earth by Slieve na Mon. It lay dormant for one winter, escaped the snout of pig and foot of woodcairn, and began its slow journey towards my elbow. In the lush valley of the shore, cleric, lord, and peasant, year by year extemporized the land's entangled story. Through circumstantial dark and day of 10 generations, oakwood grew, aloof from birth cries, love cries, battle cries, until it reached maturity with Black Tom Butler, Earl of Ormond, and Elizabeth's best man in Ireland, who loved the land, but also loved his queen, who may have known Shakespeare, who parlayed with the great O'Neill, and took the sword through Munster, who sent the head of Desmond to London in a basket. By Black Tom's order, oak was felled and hauled to Carrick to build a lightsome manor house beside the river in the castle of his ancestors. His Gaelic poet, Owen McCrae, sang the manor's praises. Graft into the grain of the oak beams, another 3 slow centuries of passing footsteps through the long gallery, while the river shore, by mullioned windows, tied it twice through every turning of the light and dark. When my great-grandfather was a boatman on the river, the Marquess from Kilkenny gave the last banquet in the hall at Carrick for tenantry and old retainers. A new tide brought the Irish state to hold the mansion for the people. And in my time, a carpenter, replacing floor beams of the long gallery, gave me a block of oak. Last year, I took my slow-grained prize of time to Bruce MacDonald of Tasmania in County Waterford, who turned his craft to it and shaped this bowl that rests beside my elbow. It may in time be someone's heirloom. What happens next is stirring in the dark that waits behind my shoulder. The story's open-ended.
The past is the only time which is accessible to us in some way. It is part of the material given to us. And when you live in a small town, I've lived here all my life, virtually, and you can focus on the grain of the wood almost. I have a strong sense of the fact that we live in spaces which have been vacated by others, other lives before us. That sense of spaces where other people have lived, I find a very potent thing. Not many people realize, I think, that just yards from the main street is Carrick's medieval burial ground of St. Nicholas. There are 6 centuries of burials here, Protestant and Catholic, and this last Protestant church on the site is now being restored as a heritage center for the town. I feel that I'm at the center of my personal cosmos here, the heart of old Carrick. Job Wilkes of the 56th Regiment, who was accidentally drowned at Carrick and Shore on the 17th of July, 1868, in his 28th year.
How commonplace, Job Wilkes. How strange that this should be where it would end for you 28 summers after the midwife washed you. With that first immersion, you took your part in the music of what happens. And an Irish river was flowing to meet you, make you intimate clay of my town.
Every river town has its litany of drownings. This is what remains of a memorial commemorating the deaths of 106 people, most of them women and children, who were drowned at Carrick Bridge when a barge from Clonmel on a heavy flood smashed against the bridge in 1799. The Herbert family of Carrickinshaw and Muckross. Dorothea Herbert was the tragic daughter of the rector here in the late 18th century. Her retrospections were published 100 years after she died.
Hugh Ryan has been a passionate collector of books all his life.
Hi, Hugh.
Books and memorabilia, especially relating to local things. And contact with him has opened up dimensions of the local for me that I wouldn't have been aware of. And he was originally went as an orphan, as a 13-year-old orphan apprentice into Burke's Drapery, one of the long-established draperies in Carrick.
Not too bad at all. Not too bad at all. Carrying on the usual.
Yes.
And kill the time all day long.
Killing the time, yes. You have a lot of time in your hands now.
A lot of time in my hands. And mind you, first when I left the job, the doctor said to me, what are you going to do with yourself now? I'm going to live as long as I can, I said.
Yes. Yeah. And, that's the idea.
It was the idea at the time, I think. I don't think
this passion of books was his great motivation all his life. There are people like that, I think, that you encounter, if you're lucky, who, in a sense, educate you more than your formal contact with education does sometimes.
Twelve Nights at the Abbey Theatre, Grace Plunkett. Oh, this is signed also. Number 29. That's lovely here.
That's a thing that I believe myself that money wouldn't buy today.
I'm sure you're right.
Never seen it in a catalogue. I've never heard anybody speak about it or anything like that. Who gave me that was my when I came to work first in Burke's, the man who owned Burke's was a Patrick Burke. He died a very old man. But
yes.
He had a daughter who was a Mrs. Burke, who lived in Dublin. Her husband was a solicitor and very interested in the Abbey. He died during the great flu. And apparently that belonged to him. And she made me give her one promise when she gave me that. Never, as long as I could, to part with it. And that'll be there when close my eyes. Yes.
Yeah. Hugh was a very humble man. Who would make no claims to being a historian or anything else, but he is, in effect, the town's unofficial archivist.
I bought that at a button auction over the Parrells in Carrick Beg and made a heap of junk.
Living in the middle of a revolution, obviously, and we're up too close to it really to know what's happening.
down the main street in Carrick, there are two video shops. There isn't any bookshop per se, but there are two video shops. And here where I live, every Saturday night, there's a van comes around renting videos, and there's a similar situation, I'm sure, in every town in Ireland now. What that means, what it means, for example, for the future of the book, the printed book. It's quite possible that in 50 years there may be no such thing as printed books. Perhaps in some ways we're just seeing new cultural disguises, new cultural modes. We certainly are, I think. If I look at even in the video shop in the main street in Carrick, if I look at the visual iconography in the window, the visual displays which advertise the video films, in one way, I'm only seeing a retelling of things which are deep in our culture. Sagas, heroic sagas, quests, horrors and heroes, and struggles. Things are constantly recycled, perhaps, and we just fail to see through the disguises. The video shop is as full of folklore, perhaps, as the room where the Shanachie spoke.
You're not going back for 3 hours. You're alive, don't get Jack.
And only 24 hours left for Jack to get out of danger so that Tara can get out of Jack.
I got married relatively late, I suppose. I was in my 30s, my mid-30s. I remember an old teacher saying to me one time that you didn't understand children until you had children of your own, and I think that there's something in that, and I think that there's something sad about not having children. People who for one reason or another, through choice or chance or whatever, don't have children. I find sad. I've known people in my life whose lives reached a full stop in the sense that they hadn't married and they hadn't had children. And I feel that is, in some way, a sad thing to happen to anybody, though it does happen to quite a lot of people.
How odd of my wife, I thought at the time, to pluck bay leaves to season her stews from a tree that shades the grave of a girl in Kilclisbean. Mary Dempsey knew 17 springs before they laid her into the earth, before the bay tree put down roots, before my mother and father knew the fruit of the tree of life. Sitting at table with wife and child, I relish the dish and acknowledge the guest who is part of the feast. You're welcome, Mary, into my house. And you're more than welcome into my mouth. For this is the way the world goes round. From the first kiss to the baby's milk. From the first word to the tongue's last sound. Bread of communion we taste in the mouth is broken in commonwealth under the ground.
I didn't expect to ever to write about my family. I didn't sort of see that as material. But there was a story in my background, and every family has a story. Everybody has a story, a family story. I think there's a kind of an inherited archaeology of the emotions, which, because it is an archaeology, is buried. And we're only partly aware of. I think there are ghosts in our genes because we are a mixture of other people. of other lives and other dramas. I believe that kind of buried archaeology of the emotions can pass down through generations.
The seed, the sun, the days, the leaf and bird song, the axe, the saw and plane, the hands, the years on layered years of tar, the blister and the scar of weathers. All topped in time with this inspired epiphany of blue, the deep, dark blue of spaces, silences. Behind it, through the slow turn of nights, the ritual of hands with yeast and flour, with salt and water. And from the oven, time and time again, the incensed miracle of bread, its truth and grace, brought out to light and offered to the morning. All the while the wood was earning its adagio complexity under the palette knife of cold and heat, of dark and wind and day, of goings and returnings. Yes, all of its timescaped behind a child who's playing hopscotch on the footpath, who's dancing between earth and air, against this scarred epiphany of blue, the deep, dark blue of spaces, silences.
George Anahan continues the family craft of basket making. And in fact, it has taken him as far afield as Bloomingdale's in New York City. I like the symbolism of making the basket anyway, apart from the craft, which is something that should interest any writer, the whole idea of craft. But I also like the symbol of making the basket, the strength of the basket, the materials it's made from, the hands of the man who makes the basket, and the fact that a basket is something that contains or is made to contain something. It's open, but it's a container. And that's a kind of a metaphor that appeals to me as somebody who tries to write poetry.
How are you, Joe?
Michael. How are things?
Not too bad. Hard at it.
Yes, Michael.
What are you working on?
I'm doing linen baskets at the moment. I have a dozen to make.
I wonder if you have time to let me in over to have a look at the records again.
No problem, Michael. Give me a second.
Joe is also, or was, the sacristan of my parish church for many years, for over 30 years, when he rang the bells and prepared the settings for the rites and the mysteries in my local parish church. There's a ritual of keys when he unlocks for me the parish registers, the volumes of Latin inscriptions which record 2 centuries of baptisms and marriages. I see them as a kind of a communal lexicon, an intimate communal lexicon. And their real gravitas is felt when you search through them in the sacristy, in the silence of the sacristy for hours, going from page to page and overviewing whole generations. That there's an immediacy about them that fascinates me, that their distance and their immediacy, that each entry has this sense of the immediate moment of its writing comes off the page, the day and the year and the century in which it was written. For example, I can almost touch a day in February of 1876 when an infant was brought to the sacristy from Oven Lane and baptized and christened Michael. And some priest dipped pen in ink and wrote it down. And in the future, in the unformed future, that child would become my grandfather, a part of a complex interweave of human chance and choice and possibility. About this whole parish thing, Patrick Kavanagh has made an important distinction between provincialism, which always has its center elsewhere, and his concept of the parish, which is its own center, concerned with fundamentals, and therefore Kavanagh would say universal.
I came to teach in Carrick partly through economic circumstances, family circumstances. I was needed. My father was ill and I had a chance of a job here. And some people advised me not to come to Carrick. There was a sort of a conventional wisdom in the teaching profession that you didn't teach in your hometown because you wouldn't be able to maintain a certain distance, people thought, from your pupils. I never subscribed to that idea and I never found it the slightest problem. I liked teaching. I find I'm almost 30 years teaching in my hometown now, and I think that 30 years is a lot of teaching, and it's the kind of a job which sucks something from you in a gradual way. There's a kind of a slow attrition in the job, I think, and it's difficult to meet the challenge of it all the time. I've never considered myself an efficient teacher. Whether I'm a good teacher or not, I don't really know.
I belong to a particular tradition, the Roman Catholic tradition, and I belong to it in a way, and I feel an allegiance to it in a way, which I don't particularly try to define closely. I don't think, I prefer not to define it too closely. I think one of the tragedies of the Irish Church is that it is still largely frozen in the 19th century in terms of its structures, and I'm not at all sure that it can extricate itself from those structures. I think it is arthritic to the point perhaps where it won't be able to extricate itself in time to renew itself for the new world. Here in Carrick, the Christian Brothers and the 2 orders of nuns, the Presentation and the Mercy, are quite obviously in retreat. And that is a situation which is sad in its way, you could say natural in its way, that these men and women came and answered needs in their time, and answered them well in many respects. Like many people of my generation, I would have very affectionate feelings towards many members of the nuns and the brothers who gave me things and gave their lives to something. Now, in both convents, the majority of the nuns who are left are old and trying to take care of each other. The end of anything is sad.
But yeah. How do you see the future in terms of the convents and the religious orders?
Oh, in terms of religious orders? I think they will exist, but they may not be exactly the same as they were.
Mm.
They will be different. And yes. Like there will always be, I think, in the an interest in education, I think.
Yes.
Like, I think it would be a pity if they weren't, like, but because they lose contact with all young people, you know.
Yes.
But oftentimes people come back here, most of them, that ever...
Would it be a fair thing to say that the religious orders of the 19th century, the nuns and the brothers, came and did their work when it was needed, and that perhaps the end of that has come, and something new.
And there'll be different needs, I'd say, and different dress and everything. Like even as it is today, you know, I wouldn't be dressed like this.
Indeed, no.
And 20, 30 years ago.
And you probably never thought you'd go to California.
I never thought I would. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I never thought I would.
So you'd be hopeful.
I would. I'd be hopeful that there will be religious orders, I said, of some. They may not be the same as the ones that we have nowadays, but there will be some, I'd say.
Yeah. Do you welcome the changes in the church?
Yes, I do. I mean, I can see no future, but you've just to go, keep going, like, we can't turn back the clock.
I don't understand why you let things you get so out of hand. You'd have managed better if you'd had a plan. Why the future back with time is such a strange land. If you come today, you would have reached the whole nation.
Other people say that Carrick has a very strong sense of drama and of music and achievement in both of these fields. Carrick has two theatres, for example, and its musical and drama groups are well known all over the country.
Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, who are you, what have you sacrificed?
I remember in the 50s when I was a schoolboy, my father came home one night full of enthusiasm, a special kind of enthusiasm, just having seen a production of The Playboy of the Western World, which Liam Clancy directed at the time. And I got the feeling at the time that my father was trying to tell me that he had seen something special. Would you say that that production, Peg, was seminal in the town in terms of drama?
I think it was, Michael. It was something special for all of us. It was sort of a beginning as far as the drama group in town was concerned. Certainly for me, it was something special. It was the first real play that I was in. I had been in many musicals because, as you know, the Musical Society was very strong in the town at the time, and we'd all been involved in musicals and pantomimes. But a real play was certainly something special, and we all enjoyed it immensely.
Liam, I think I remember hearing that Playboy production caused a little bit of a clerical rumpus at the time.
Yes, we had a local curate, Father Harty, at the time, and he disapproved of the play. He thought it was unchristian and rather pagan in its tone and attitudes. He came down one night, and after the performance was over, he made a little speech, more or less to that effect. And I remember Liam Clancy and myself, we were standing on stage, and of course we were young and enthusiastic and feeling rather frustrated and rather angry. But of course, looking back now, you know, we can understand, I suppose, that Father Harty was a man of a different generation with a different point of view. And if he came back today and discovered that the same play was being studied on the Leaving Certificate programme, he would, I suppose, be horrified.
My mother came from a very musical background in Waterford City,
And as a young woman, she even had her own dance band. I have a poster here for a dance in 1937. Said Stephen's Night in 1937. Music by Miss Doreen Power's dance band, Waterford. Dance to 4 a.m. It was at a dance in Carrick, in fact, that my father happened to meet my mother. She was playing at a dance in Carrick, and they had a sort of a whirlwind courtship and were married 3 months later. My mother's music became an important thing when I was growing up, because it often kept bread on the table when my father was sick or unemployed, and my mother played at dances even sometimes when she was heavily pregnant.
Another hard day.
It hurt.
Well, you know. Where did this fall out of?
Oh, I found that upstairs.
Many of my family photographs are, in fact, band photographs, because the family has been part of the brass band in Carrick for several generations, like other families in the town. And my grandfather was a young man here, with many of the old-timers, people like the old Bard Power, who was alleged to have made himself a set of false teeth for trombone-playing purposes when his own teeth went. The band fed many other musical forms of life in the town, and my grandfather later became the conductor of the band. It seems to me an extraordinary sort of a thing that this was the abandoned child of Oven Lane. He died young of TB, which was a family scourge. And he passed on something of his sense of culture, I think, to my father and his other children, his sons Peter and Jimmy, all of whom went to America in the 20s. And my own father sent this Metropolitan Opera House program back in 1927 to his father. I think it's an unusual thing that three ragged-arsed young Irish emigrants, my father and his brothers Peter and Jimmy, were going and queuing for the Metropolitan Opera House in New York, where they could stand for $3. My father actually marked the spot on the theater plan here where they stood for $3. And the opera they saw on this particular occasion was The Force of Destiny, something which tickles my imagination because it ties in with some of the themes I write about.
There's the wallflower shell of the Wadden Charity, 1756, where my great-great-grandfather, the boatman Jimmy Cody of Hayes's Lane, died in 1895, attended only by his grandson, Michael, who'd been raised as an orphan after his father skipped around 1880 to marry again, with a woman named Brunock in Philadelphia, where they were lost to view. While the child, my grandfather, Michael, became a skilled solicitor's clerk, played billiards, the fiddle, drank. Once threw a Christmas pudding into the fire, and my grandmother, oh, a hard woman of the Victorian shopkeeper class, had taken the hatchet to his irresponsible fiddle once and for all, or so she believed in her Beecham's pills and the strength of her corseted rosaries.
Let her ray, lads, again. Not too strong this time. And
death of TB in 1932, the brass band, sober in black, slow marched the large and representative attendance, including afflicted widow, across the old bridge, 1447, to the dead march from Saul. And with cases of stout in the offing for the gaslit years of nights he'd conducted them through pinafore, maritana, poet and peasant, never having forgiven his son, my father, George, for a cracked high B flat in the solo euphonium cadenza at the great band contest, Wexford, 1925. So that all his life, that cracked high B flat haunted my father until his death, not quite sober, in 1973. Just as he'd sung, "There's a long, long trail of winding into the land of my dreams." At which stage, I was a man of sorts, sidling towards marriage and having my own troubles with high B flat on the trombone. Something to do with the shape of the family mouth. Not to mention an old woman, 93 but not telling, who smiles at me every Sunday, who long ago played the piano, especially duets with my grandfather, Michael. And I've heard their long ago music, put the Christmas pudding into the fire and the fiddle in smithereens. I'd love to ask her straight out before she dies if it's true she had a musical fling with my grandfather 70 years ago, but of course she's a lady and won't ever tell. That's me now, standing outside the butcher's at the top of New Street, glasses and developing paunch at 4:30 in May 1983, high on the wall-flowered shell of the Wadden Charity, 1756, where my great-great-grandfather died in 1895, just up the street from the town hall, where every Tuesday night I conduct the brass band with tolerance and even love for cracked high B flats. At the moment, 4:30 in May 1983, I'm still above ground and feel okay. And I mean to be drunk tonight for unstoppable wallflowers, not to mention my wife who's pregnant, and much else besides, such as that man at the corner who can unblock the drains, dig the graves, put out fires, arrest stray dogs, or sing like Slim Whitman. Or the way that the girl who works in the bookies moves as she walks across the street and into the butcher's behind me. Or the shape of the consequential clouds at this moment over my head.
I find the whole emigration thing appalling. And what's even more appalling is the lack of rage about it. The whole class I went through primary school with, I think that there might be two or three of us left in Carrick, and maybe I might know of five or six more who are in Ireland. Others are as gone as effectively as if they were dead to me. And that a country should accept that and continue to accept it seems to me to be an absolute tragedy. We don't even count them. We care so little about it that we don't even count them. In fact, there's a political conspiracy not to count them, and there has always been. No government wants to know about emigration. It's saving their economic bacon in one way, and they just don't even want to count the people as they go.
But I was telling you, I was talking to my friend Michael Cody, the poet in Carrick-on-Shore, and he told me a fascinating story about his great-grandfather, James Cody, who left Carrick under absolutely desperate circumstances 100 years ago, after his wife had died giving birth to their second child. He left his first son behind him. James Cody took off for America and wasn't heard from for 30 years. And Michael told me when his father was a child, he remembers his father, Michael's grandfather, getting a letter from America after 30 years from Philadelphia. Remember the color of the envelope. He opened it, he read it. He had been brought up as a virtual orphan, he cried. He tore the letter into shreds and threw it in the fire. And what Michael's father always wondered about was, It took 30 years to write the letter. How long did he wait to be given absolution and for that letter to come back from Ireland saying, we forgive you? It never came. Michael tried to write a poem about it, and he said himself that instead of writing a poem, he wrote an answer to a letter that had been written four generations before. And he tried to heal a wound that had crossed 100 years of time. And he called it the letter. I'll give it to you. Let me try to know you in the anguish of that hour. A man of no importance, trapped in a narrow place, enmeshed in desperate circumstance, as at the whim of some malignant puppeteer. The image holds the lane, its stench. The fetid hovels crowding down towards the quayside of the shore, where kinship and compassion resurrect in time upon the page. The murmured solidarity and flickering of candles about the human face of piteous travail. 100 years, and I will come to try the lane for echoes. The coughing and the crying of children in the dark. The nameless incarnations of love and grief and hunger. Where the river flows coldly past. These broken walls were witness to your leaving, whether in morning sun or rain, your firstborn child still sleeping when you left him, the dark child blessings from the doorways of a lane you'd never see again. What I know has come to me out of dead mouths, through the barefoot child left with your own father, the old boatman. And from the mouth of my father, that child's son. A life I'll never know is buried with you in a place I'll never find. A generation turned before the morning of the letter. Sent to find your son become a man with children of his own. Out of the maze of circumstance, the raveled tangle of effect and cause, something impelled you, brought you finally to bend above the unmarked page, an old man in some room in Philadelphia, reaching for words to bridge the ocean of his silence, pleading forgiveness of the child of Oven Lane. Silence was the bitter answer you were given every empty day until you died. By a breakfast table, my child father watched your son unseal his darkest pain, saw the pages torn and cast in mortal grief and anger out of an abandoned child's unspeakable heart hunger into the brute finality of flame.
There's the whole subterranean culture of our indigenous traditions, our Gaelic traditions, which interests me greatly and which I found my own way to. The holy well of Cuan at Mothal on the County Waterford side of Carrick has a special significance for me. The ash tree is reputed to be 300 years old, but under it, the spring, the lovely spring, is ice cold and pure, even in midsummer. And people still come there on Pattern Day, on the second Sunday of July, to do the traditional rounds. I think that they almost come there without realizing why they're going there. They answer, they respond to something instinctive and duchsach in themselves, a celebration of fertility and life and continuity. Across the Shore Valley and on the other side, across and under Slievenamon, is Kilcash, which was immortalized in the well-known Gaelic lament. Kilcash was sung for its trees, and for a woman's kindness. And somehow the song in the mouth of the singer is whole and untouchable.
Ní clillin fóin lochin, ná géal, ná fialar a géif cuscún. Ná fiúl a maca an saithe, ár mil agus air an tlú. Níl ciol bain milli,
I find it very difficult to imagine what Carrick looks or feels like, or is how it is evaluated by people from the outside, because I am so much inside it. I wouldn't make any special claims for it. I would say that it has the virtues of any small community, a certain intimacy and relaxation, and a caring, an individual caring for people, because they know each other, and there's the accumulated sense of people sharing things. It also has the vices of all small communities, certain amount of malice or begrudgery or lack of imaginative outreach. And I don't posit any particular virtue in small towns or small communities other than larger ones. They are different. I happen to live in a small one, and irrespective of whether you think you love it or hate it, it is part of you. I think when you live in a place long enough, in fact, the place in which you're born haunts you anyway for the rest of your life, even if you get out of it, which I didn't. I think it will haunt you in any case.
Like a tin. The older you get, the better.